Hachette Audio presents Dialogue, the art of verbal action for page, stage, and screen. Written by Robert McKee. Read by Robert McKee with scenes by David Pitou and Orla Cassidy. Please refer to the PDF that accompanies this audiobook.
For Mia, when she speaks, my heart listens. Preface, in praise of dialogue. We talk. Talk, more than any other trait, expresses our humanity. We whisper to lovers, curse enemies, argue with plumbers, praise the dog, swear on our mother's grave. Human relationships are, in essence, long, long talks into, around, through, and out of the entanglements that stress or bless our days. Face-to-face talk between family and friends may go on for decades, while self-to-self talk never ends. A guilt-ridden conscience scolds unconscionable desires. Ignorance ridicules wisdom, hope consoles despair, impulse mocks caution, and wit laughs at it all as the inner voices of our best and worst selves argue to our last breath. Over decades, this downpour of talk can drain words of their meaning, and when meaning erodes, our days shallow out. But what time dilutes, story condenses. Authors concentrate meaning by first eliminating the banalities, minutiae, and repetitious chatter of daily life. They then build their tellings into a crisis of complex, conflicting desires. Under pressure, words fill with connotation and nuance. What a character says in the face of conflict radiates the meanings hidden behind her words. Expressive dialogue becomes a translucency through which readers and audiences perceive thoughts and feelings shadowed in the silence behind a character's eyes. Fine writing turns audiences and readers into virtual psychics. Dramatized dialogue has the power to unite two unspoken realms, the inner life of a character and the inner life of the reader audience. Like radio transmitters, one subconscious tunes to another, as our instincts sense the churnings within characters. As Kenneth Burke put it, stories equip us to live in the world in intimacy with others and, most importantly, in intimacy with ourselves. Authors give us this power through a series of steps. First, they create those metaphors for human nature we call characters. Next, they dig into the characters' psychologies to unearth conscious wishes and subconscious desires, those longings that impel inner and outer selves. With this insight in hand, writers clash the character's most compelling desires into flashpoints of conflict. Scene after scene, they interlace their character's actions and reactions around turning points of change. In a last step, authors let their characters speak, but not in the repetitious monotones of the everyday, rather in the demi-poetry known as dialogue. Like an alchemist, a writer mixes and molds concoctions of character, conflict, and change, and then gilds them with dialogue, transforming the base metal of existence into the burnished gold of story. Once spoken, dialogue carries us on waves of sensation and substance that reverberate through the said, to the unsaid, to the unsayable. The said are those ideas and emotions a character chooses to express to others. The unsaid are those thoughts and feelings a character expresses in an inner voice, but only to himself. The unsayable are those subconscious urges and desires a character cannot express in words, even to himself, because they are mute and beyond awareness. No matter how lavish a play's production, how vivid a novel's descriptions, how lush a film's photography, Character talk shapes the deepest complexities, ironies, and innerness of story. Without expressive dialogue, events lack depth, characters lose dimension, and story flattens out. More than any other technique of characterization, gender, age, dress, class, casting, dialogue has the power to pull a story up through life's multi-layered strata, thus lifting a merely complicated telling into the full array of complexity. Do you, like me, memorize favorite lines? I think we learn dialogue passages by heart because reciting them again and again not only re-inspires the vivid word pictures they paint, but in the echoes of the characters' thoughts, we hear our own.
Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time, and all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death.
Macbeth, in the tragedy of Macbeth. Of all the gin joints in all the towns in all the world, she walks into mine. Rick, in Casablanca.
Towards thee I roll, thou all-destroying but unconquering whale. To the last I grapple with thee, from hell's heart I stab at thee. For hate's sake I spit my last breath at thee.
Ahab, in Moby Dick.
Not that there's anything wrong with that. Jerry, in Seinfeld.
Like these four characters, each of us has suffered the scald of irony, that flash of insight into what the world has done to us, or worse yet, what we've done to ourselves, that double-edged moment when life's joke is on us and we don't know whether to grin or groan. But without writers to marinate these ironies in words, how could we savor their delicious distaste? Without the mnemonics of dialogue, how could we hold these paradoxes in memory? I love the art of dialogue in all of its variety. Moved by that enmity, I have written Dialogue, the Art of Verbal Action for Page, Stage, Screen, to explore the crowning act of story-making, giving voice to your characters. Introduction. Part 1. The Art of Dialogue radically expands the definition of dialogue and multiplies its usage. Chapters 2 through 5 look at the functions, content, forms, and techniques of character talk across the four major storytelling media. Part 2, Flaws and Fixes, pinpoints maladies from incredibility and cliches to writing on the nose and repetitiousness, seeks their causes, then prescribes cures. To illustrate the varied techniques of crafting dialogue, I cite examples from novels, plays, films, and television. Part 3, Creating Dialogue, examines the writer's final step, finding the words that create the text. When we say an author has an ear for dialogue, we mean he writes character-specific talk. Each of his characters speaks with a syntax, rhythm, tonality, and most importantly, word choices that no one but that character would use. Ideally, every character is a walking dictionary of his or her unique collection of words. Dialogue originality, therefore, begins with vocabulary. To illustrate the power of character-specific dialogue, we will look at scenes from Shakespeare's play, The Tragedy of Julius Caesar, Elmore Leonard's novel, Out of Sight, Tina Fey's television series, 30 Rock, and Alexander Payne and Jim Taylor's film, Sideways. Part 4, Dialogue Design, opens with a study of the components of story and scene design. Chapter 12 shows how these forms determine what characters say. Six case studies follow, using scenes of balanced conflict from the cable series The Sopranos, comic conflict from the network series Frasier, asymmetric conflict from the play A Raisin in the Sun, indirect conflict from the novel The Great Gatsby, reflexive conflict from the novels Fräulein Else and The Museum of Innocence, and implied conflict from the film Lost in Translation. In these scansions, we will look at the two primary principles of effective dialogue. First, each exchange of dialogue creates an action-reaction that progresses the scene. Second, although these actions find expression in the outer behavior of talk, the wellspring of character action flows invisibly from the.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.